Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Foreign Service Institute Mabini Dialogue. In August of last year, the Philippine government, in cooperation with the International Atomic Energy Agency and the International Framework for Nuclear Energy Cooperation, hosted a conference on the prospects of nuclear power in the Asia-Pacific. Such event was part of the country's commitment of exploring all alternative energy resources to ensure supply security and stability. Indeed, energy is crucial for sustainable economic growth and improved human welfare. The Philippines has been contemplating and is currently embarking on nuclear development projects. What then does it mean for the Philippine society? What are the implications of having a nuclear program? These and other issues will be discussed in this afternoon's event. Today, we are very privileged to have Mr. John Tileman, hope I pronounce it correctly, to speak on the various considerations relating to the adoption of nuclear power. Mr. Tileman is Director of Research for the Asia-Pacific Leadership Network for Nuclear Non-Proliferation and Disarmament. Previously, he was a career diplomat in the Australian Foreign Service. His career included extensive involvement in nuclear affairs in Canberra, and he represented Australia at various international forums, including the NPT Review Conferences, the PSI, the ARF ISMs on Non-Proliferation and Disarmament, and at ASEAN Expert Control Seminars. In Vienna, he was Australia's Deputy Permanent Representative to the IAEA and was subsequently seconded as Chief of Staff to two IAEA's DGs. He was Australia's Ambassador to Jordan from 2002 to 2006 and has also served previously in Thailand, Sri Lanka, Pakistan, and Poland. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm round of applause to Mr. John Tileman.
Thank you very much, Carla, and good afternoon, everybody. Lovely to see such a lively and dare I say, young group here, because there is one major problem which we face, those of us who are interested in nuclear matters, is that the aging population of people who are interested in nuclear affairs, and particularly with the country contemplating going down the road of nuclear power, is going to need a vast army of experts to make that possible. As Carla mentioned, I've been involved in nuclear matters for quite some time, but just to give you an indication of just how old my interest in this is, I mark this year the 55th anniversary of my baptism in nuclear matters, and it was the Cuban Missile Crisis, when Kennedy and Khrushchev were facing off, and I was a young school kid, 15 years old, and I had the fear of God in me that, you know, this was going to be my last few weeks, and the world would never be the same again. Well, we survived that one, and as one of my mentors, Gareth Evans, a former Foreign Minister of Australia who has a passionate interest in matters nuclear, likes to put it, we've survived this long through sheer dumb luck. Anybody who recalls the Cuban Missile Crisis will know that there was a time when a Soviet submarine was lurking underneath US warships, and according to its rule book, it should have fired a nuclear death charge to get rid of this lurking American warship, and they chose not to, and the possible start of a nuclear war was avoided, again, by almost sheer dumb luck. Anyway, we've survived another 55 years. Sadly, things haven't got that much better. In fact, in many respects, the gains that we made between 1962 and 1992, I suppose, that 30-year window after that 30-year Cold War, quite a good deal of progress was made in the disarmament area. What we see now, though, is, I'm afraid, a freezing of relations again between the US and Moscow, a hardening of relations between the US and China, and of course the wild card in the region, DPRK, quite clearly now has a nuclear capability. We can debate about how accurate it is, how many weapons they've got, whether they can only hit San Francisco or whether they can hit New York. But either way, it seems to me, and it seems to most, I think, people who study this matter, that the risk is there, it's very high, and the DPRK could initiate a nuclear exchange. So the situation globally on the nuclear arms front is not very positive. On the nuclear power side, of course, the peaceful uses of nuclear energy, there's a very mixed picture. We've got, on the one hand, an ever-widening use of nuclear technology in everyday applications. Pretty well every major hospital in the world has a nuclear science area. The prime target is cancer treatment, but there are several other applications in medicine. And it's also, nuclear techniques are used in agriculture, in environmental studies, so on. There's not much dispute about that. There's an issue, what to do with these radiation sources, the things you use to create these applications. They've got to be managed properly. You don't want to lose them. You lose them, they go into a metal junkyard. They can kill people, as happened in Latin America a couple of times, or it can contaminate a whole metal meltdown workshop, as happened with some Australian stuff that once went to Singapore, and 30 years, 40 years ago now, but it mucked up a whole Singaporean iron recycling facility. So, those applications are pretty universally accepted and not hotly debated. Nuclear power, of course, as you all know, is a very different matter, and I feel really quite strange to be standing here before you and talking about this issue, because it was 20 years ago I was doing much the same sort of talk in Indonesia, when Indonesia was thinking about, seriously yet again, thinking about going to nuclear power. And that was the time of one of the financial crises, and that very evening, talking to some people over dinner, the daughter of one of our nuclear research center counterparts came and joined us at dinner. She'd been working at the central bank and said, "Oh, dear Daddy, something funny happened at work today. The repeater is starting to melt down." Well, she didn't use that word, but that's what in fact happened. Anyway, that put the whole nuclear option off the Indonesian agenda for another 10 years. From a pure financial point of view, they're talking about meltdowns, of course, Fukushima. So, frankly speaking, any country looking to go down the nuclear power route for the first time is being very brave. Because you're not going down it for the first time. You've been down it, and I haven't been to visit it, but one day I'd like to visit. I gather it's only 50 kilometres as the crow flies, a bit longer if you go around the bay to get to Bataan. But there you've got a lovely reactor sitting there waiting to do something. I've visited one like that before in Austria, just down the road from Vienna, Svetendorf, a lovely little village on the Danube. And they've got a lovely nuclear power plant that they were ready to fire up probably about the same time, 1980, 81, I don't know. And they had a referendum on it. That was a pretty dumb thing because the referendum was lost by 1% of the vote or whatever else. Anyway, that was the end of the nuclear power program. That facility sits there to this day, and there's absolutely no suggestion in Austria that they're ever going to restart it. They've turned that into a museum. I visited it once and got shown over it, and it's very interesting from a point of view of a non-technical person to see what the real insides of a nuclear power plant looks like. So all by way of saying that the question of going for a nuclear power option is a very big undertaking for any country. And in the time we've got today, I'd just like to run you through some of the dimensions of the issue of going down the nuclear power route. and I'll take you through those headings there. Well, my time in government service was mainly dealing with the nuclear disarmament side of the business. I did also deal with selling Australian uranium, well, more to the point, the legal frameworks within which Australia sells uranium, which is a whole other story, but and we'll come to it because we have an agreement with the Philippines for the sale of uranium. When the time comes, we have got a basis there for doing it. So I'll run through some of these basic elements, and I'm told that we have till about 3 o'clock. If I can bore you to that point, and then we can do some questions and whatever. So let's start with the fundamentals. The non-proliferation of the treaty, the basic framework for keeping the nuclear weapons, keeping non-nuclear countries that don't have nuclear weapons, the main framework for keeping them without nuclear weapons, countries like Australia and the Philippines have decided not to go down the route of nuclear weapons, put their trust in the non-proliferation treaty. And that treaty in Article 4 has a provision which basically says that your rights to the peaceful uses of nuclear energy are hereby enshrined. So no one can tell you you don't have a right to have nuclear applications, and no one can tell you as a country you don't have a right to have nuclear power. But countries will argue about exactly how much that right can be carried, taken forward. But having nuclear power is absolutely inalienable. But to be sure, a decision to go down that route will be not only a big step for a country to take from the point of view of a national decision of what your energy sources into the future are going to be, because here we're talking about a decision which will have implications, as you know, for many decades. And it's not just the decision of what would be the most economic, because more or less when you've made the decision to go down that route, the economics will have to be almost lived with for a long, long time, because you've got that asset which will continue to require maintenance, operational servicing and the rest of it for a long time, and then you've got things like waste which will come to. But it'll be a huge decision as a national decision, as an energy choice. But it will also be a decision which you won't take in isolation. Neighbours, even for a country such as Philippines, some distance from nearest neighbours, well, you're not actually, at some points you're not very far away from Indonesia and whatever, and not too far away from Taiwan, what, 1,000 kilometres from Vietnam and China. So these distances are not huge, and in any event, they will all your neighbouring countries and others further afield will want to know that your program is both peaceful and safe and secure from misuse for any non-state actor activity. And you will also be investing in a long-term arrangement with suppliers of nuclear technology and probably the uranium fuel for that system, which will lock you deeply into a set of arrangements with a foreign vendor or number of vendors. It's not unique to nuclear, but in nuclear's case, it's pretty intense, pretty full on, and there's only a limited number of players, so it's not like buying coal or a coal-fired power plant or a gas-fired plant. The nuclear arena is smaller, more intense, and more, arguably more complex and regulated, which gets to the point of the complex set of international rules and standards, which we'll come back to. So the first decision, of course, is whether nuclear power is the right decision for the Philippines. Hugely political decision domestically, as I've explained, but one which will be of great interest to your neighbours. The point to make here is that probably from the very beginning, and in fact, as Carl has explained, there is already a framework, an international framework, which can help each country make such a decision. And that's largely a framework defined by the International Atomic Energy Agency. And maybe it's worth just saying a few words about the International Atomic Energy Agency, which is an organisation I actually worked with for 6 years and worked on for in Vienna for 9 years. It's quite a large outfit. I thought I had a note here of the numbers, but no, I don't. 2,000 odd employees, professionals. It's a totally multinational structure. Domingo Ciazon, one of your famous international civil servants who served at UNIDO for many years, was a candidate for the head of the International Atomic Energy Agency at one time. So you could have been the boss of this outfit, but it wasn't to turn out to be that way. Instead, Domingo took on the Industrial Development Organization, another very large and important international organization based in Vienna. But the International Atomic Energy Agency performs two basic functions, arguably three, but it does the regulatory side of things and it does the promotional side. And this has been criticized by some as being incompatible. How can the regulator be also a promoter? Well, they do it by a rather primitive form of siloing, I guess is the word. So the inspectors do their inspections and work pretty much in a world of their own, whereas the people who do the technical cooperation programs and the rest of it work in a world of their own. And the third leg is really the safety and security people who do their work, again, more or less in a form of isolation. That has some disadvantages, siloing, but on the other hand, it helps to prevent the contamination of the promoters, the contamination of the regulators by the ambitions and enthusiasm of the promoters. International Atomic Energy Agency is a freestanding organ of the UN system. It has its own constitution, statute, it has its own membership, so it has 168 thereabouts at the moment members, so it's not the same number of members as the United Nations, which has 198 or something like that. And it's the preeminent organization for setting goals and setting standards and rules for the nuclear industry. And it covers both the nuclear power and covers nuclear applications, the isotope applications. So, what did I say? Yes. The point about it, at the point of the energy needs options. So when the Philippines is contemplating its energy choices, it has several sources, of international expertise that can contribute to that national process. But the IAEA can give advice, and it's probably fair to say that it's not going to be unambiguously positive towards the nuclear option. They try to be pretty hard-headed about it. Some time ago, they had a very interesting program to assess the relative environmental impacts of different energy sources. And to be clear, nuclear power is very low on carbon emissions, for example, but it's not completely free of carbon emissions, because you think of the nuclear power plants take up a huge amount of concrete, which is a big carbon-producing industry. You need energy. energy to enrich uranium, one of the fuel sources that takes up a lot of electricity. Initial electricity is also nuclear electricity. That electricity is going to produce carbon. So, you know, there are various factors, but it's as good a good choice from the carbon point of view as you can find, but it's not completely free of carbon production or other environmental impacts. But from an aesthetic point of view, and I haven't seen the time, but I know there's one down on the Danube, I believe, the Austrian one. Compared to a coal-fired power plant, which we have many of in Australia, and they are ugly monsters of huge masses of accumulated coal, and not to mention what they churn out. On aesthetics, nuclear wins every time. But the IAEA can help with providing a sort of level of impartial advice. There are other organisations out there that can assist. I mentioned there the IAEA DOE, and that DOE is the Philippines DOE. It's a document there which we'll check later, has done some sort of setting out the basic fundamentals of the Philippines energy situation and some speculation about the options that might be available for Philippines. And as the country goes down the route of looking at these things, it's going to have to look at the options, the technologies. Suffice to say that the great bulk of nuclear power being produced these days comes from two basic types of reactors. And the Russians produce them as the same sort of reactors. They are the pressurized water reactor, PWR, which is the one that you have sitting across the bay here, and the boiling water reactor, which I think, if I'm not mistaken, was the ones that actually got into the crisis of Fukushima, were boiling water reactors, and there are quite a few of them around the area in Japan and in Taiwan. I don't think in China, but plenty in the United States. So they're the fundamental choices of basic technology. But the Russians and the Europeans and the Japanese and the Koreans and Americans all, and French, can produce these machines or a combination of these countries together using combinations of technology can produce these machines. There's another technology which is now really out of favor. It's a Canadian technology called CANDU, a Canadian natural uranium burning reactor, which has some advantages, but also has some disadvantages and has not turned out to become very popular, although in Canada there's still a lot of them. And those reactors sadly became the basis of some proliferation in the South, because they sold CANDU reactors to Canada and to actually Canada sold reactors to India and Pakistan. They've not had a very happy reputation from a proliferation point of view. Okay, so nuclear power plants, and I make the point there on the screen that the ones I mentioned are the ones that are baseline, large plants. They're producing these days, you buy them for 1,000 megawatts plus. The one you've got, the early version of the PWR is 600 megawatts, but nowadays it's 1,000 megawatts plus, and the new one's being installed at 1,500 megawatts. But there are lots of other designs around. The problem is they haven't yet become commercially, well, they haven't become widely demonstrated, and they have not become widely put into operation outside of Russia. I think it's outside of Russia. And it's basically reactor designs, so there are others as well, but the small ones that the Russians are promoting are basically the submarine reactors. So you've got the Americans and the Chinese and the Russians and French, the Brits for that matter, but the Russians are the ones who are selling these reactors based on the submarines. So in a way, the technology is well demonstrated, because if you think of the number of submarine power, nuclear powered submarines around the globe, there are many, many, many of them. And they've been going for many, many decades. And the safety record is pretty well demonstrated. So using these little reactors, in principle, should work. And there's been a lot of enthusiasm for thinking that you could put almost sealed reactors into remote locations, or floating reactors to islands or whatever else. And Indonesia was playing around with this idea. I don't know, it's been discussed here. But the idea, in principle, is attractive. And the Boffins, the scientists, will all say, yes, yes, it can be done, it's wonderful, and it would work. But again, it's not been put into service very widely outside of Russian icebreakers and a few other unique sort of instances like this. Smaller sources are used in the Arctic Circle, where they just put in a small machine which will operate maybe a transmission station or that sort of thing for 5 years before it needs to be resurfaced. So there are things out there that have been done, but they're not in very wide use. Another big decision in making the choice to go to nuclear power is about fuel. Now, in a sense, the choice of design of the reactor will probably determine the choice of design of the fuel, and will probably narrow the range of sources from which that fuel can be got. And I make a note there that in 1982 we negotiated well before 1982, but 1982 the Australian government thought, and the Philippines government thought, that the power reactor was going to start and you were going to need to have fuel for it. And we were willing to sell our uranium, Australian uranium. It would have gone to the United States, it would have gone probably to Canada first for a process which is called, you make it into a gas anyway, uranium fluoride. Conversion is the term used for conversion to uranium fluoride. The Canadians do that very well in the seed plants there. And you then send that gas, as it is then, to the United States. In the United States, it gets enriched in the right isotope of uranium to make it all a little bit better to work in a reactor. And then the Americans would then ship it on to your reactor here, and it would be put into the reactor here. And we would still be calling it Australian uranium. And in fact, on the way, this material gets flags. So it will have an Australian flag. Because it's gone to Canada for conversion to uranium fluoride, it gets a Canadian flag, and then goes to America for enrichment, gets an American flag, then it comes here. And we're all watching it very carefully to make sure you don't do anything silly with it. And that's called national safeguards. The IAEA will watch it also, but amongst the major suppliers, having their national flag on the fuel was seen probably early 80s, from the 70s in fact, as an important addition to the non-proliferation regime, so everybody can be confident. Of open, great transparency, and we're all keeping an eye on each other to make sure we're all abiding by the rules. So you have to make a decision where to get the fuel. It would probably have to be enriched somewhere. The options these days for enrichment and fuel fabrication, like the US is still the major player, can be done in Europe, France, the UK, probably can be done in Japan. And then, at the end of the game, so you've got the fuel coming in one end, and at the other end, you've got stuff which is actually a bit nasty, in fact it's very nasty, spent fuel. What to do with it, because it's highly radioactive, and you've got to have a plan for that. And I'm afraid the global record on this is not brilliant to date. Again, the specialists will tell you, there's plenty of time, we don't have to rush this. Well, that was good 20 years ago. were probably very good 30 years ago, but today it is not looking good at all, and countries like Japan, who had ideas of doing and utilizing this spent fuel and reprocessing it, which is a fancy term for saying turning that old fuel into new fuel for other types of reactors, they're stuck with it. They're not going to have a reactor to use that fuel. They're not going to have a fast breeder program in your lifetime. So they have to do something with the spent fuel. The Koreans have got the same issue, but they had no, well, they had ambitions to do this reprocessing, but the Americans said, "Nyet, you're not allowed to do that, because that's a route to getting a bomb, and that's not allowed." So they've got the spent fuel building up in large quantities. They have to find a place to put it. Now, Australia's got some wonderful places to put this stuff, and I'm an advocate of using Australia to put this stuff, but it's actually gets to become quite a sensitive international issue when the state of South Australia, that's an area of Australia which is, South Australia is 90% desert, 85% desert, and some very good and stable desert where you could put this spent fuel without doing anything much to it, except packaging it, put it down into properly engineered holes in the ground, away from any water sources and blah, blah, blah. Geologically very stable, you can put it away. And some people thought this was very interesting. The people of South Australia were not at all interested. And some countries that were on the verge of trying to sell to their own population, we have to, on the principle, we have to look after our own waste, because no one else is going to. And then suddenly Australia says, "Oh, well, we may take it." And so that made a public acceptance problem for the governments. But Korea has not got a solution at the moment. Japan has not got a solution. The ones with closest to a solution are Finland and Sweden in Europe, two big major users of nuclear power in Europe. They've got solutions. Others are still struggling. The Americans were very close to having a solution once, and then change of administration and the whole thing went up in smoke. Politics can unravel a lot of best-laid plans. So, and I mentioned here that the parts of the enrichment where you get your fuel from, what you do with it afterwards, there are simple processes which are better than the more complex ones, and which these days really are the only solutions to the problem. It's spent fuel, sticking it in the ground, and it's getting somebody, or else somebody else taking it, and the fuel coming from another country, having the enrichment done somewhere else, and that keeps it, the whole process, free of real concerns about proliferation. Now, this is a pretty glib slide in many respects, because siting and safety are huge issues, which I'm not going to pretend to go into here, but you probably know more about it than I do. We haven't really looked at going down the nuclear power plant route in Australia since the 1970s, and don't look like going there anywhere near soon. Even though we have some of the most stable geology anywhere, Philippines, like Indonesia, like Japan, Taiwan, have major issues on the seismic side of things which require very special steps to be taken. It doesn't mean it's impossible, no, not at all. It just means it's got to be done very carefully and very well managed. And again, there's a lot of international assistance that can be brought into that, bringing the IAEA in to doing peer reviews and other sorts of things, and proposals. Maybe it's not that the IAEA and other external observers will come up with better answers than you can do generate domestically, if you have the expertise, or you buy in the expertise or whatever else. But it's a way of marketing the decision. It's a way of explaining to the population, look, world best opinion agrees with us that this is viable. And you'll need to do that too for the domestic constituency as well as for the international community. And then there's a whole set of legal standards, which we'll come to in the next slide. And again, international guides, standards, peer reviews are very important. These are where you get a country invites in top experts from the top countries around the globe. So please come have a look at what we're proposing, have a look at how far we've progressed, and have a look at what, even before the machine is decided, this is the site that we're looking at. You can get these peer reviews to apply very best global judgment to the sorts of decisions you're going to make. Now, the international legal framework, and I apologize for this scene, most of you have the hard copy there, you'll find it much easier on the eyes, and I couldn't get it from the original chart onto this screen without losing things, so you'll see there's two Koreas, but one Korea is North Korea, one Korea is South Korea, and there's no prizes for guessing which is which. The blocked out things are where the country has actually ratified the instrument, where it's still white, it's where they haven't ratified, and what am I talking about? It's the other way around. The blocked out ones where they've ratified, and the white ones are where they're not ratified, and where they've signed a treaty but not brought into force, not ratified, it's shown the sign. Now the point of this was really to draw your attention to the line of the Philippines, where there are one or two, one not signed and three which are yet to be ratified. And remind myself of what they were. In the case of the safeguards agreements, Philippines is with all the good guys, has done all the right things. It's signed the additional protocol for strengthened safeguards. It's party to the Convention on Physical Protection, the original Convention on Physical Protection, but has yet to sign up on the much advanced protocol to the original convention. The difference being the original convention dealt with the security of materials in transit, whereas the new convention adds the security of materials not just in international transit but also domestically. And then some of these conventions on safety, Philippines has signed but not ratified. The point would be, I guess, simply that you would want to attend to those things before you go down the path any further. And to underline that, this next slide draws on materials put together by the Nuclear Threat Initiative, which is a Washington-based think tank, and a bit of a disclosure here, the network that I'm working for is funded largely by the Nuclear Threat Initiative. Thank you, Nuclear Threat Initiative. It's Senator Sam Nunn and Senator Lugar, the fathers of this great American scheme which applied to the nuclear problems in the Soviet Union, when the Soviet Union collapsed and Russia was left with all this nuclear empire, a lot of it at the time in countries other than Russia, so there was Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, and this Nunn-Lugar agreement, and a lot of money that the Americans poured into the Soviet Union to put nuclear materials under control. and it was really quite fascinating. I went to one of the facilities in Russia at that in the early mid 90s, and swarming with Americans over in Russian facilities. It doesn't happen anymore, but then most of the problems have been sorted out. But there was really a dramatic need for it. Anyway, that's the Nuclear Threat Initiative, and they're still supporting people working on nuclear threats like our network. But they do every 2 years a nuclear security index. It's not about safety so much, it's about security, i.e. they're assessing how well countries are placed to prevent theft of nuclear materials, sensitive nuclear materials, from government or other controls into the hands of terrorists and others. And I should say it is hotly contested, and you'll see in a moment why. Well, you see here why. I mean, this is their findings on the Philippines, and you can read that at your leisure. But they see some gaps in Philippines performance. They do a global ranking, and again, for full disclosure, Australia comes at the top of that ranking, but it's a very easy ranking to win when you've hardly got any nuclear activity going on, except exporting uranium. It's not completely true, and we have a nuclear research establishment and whatever. But there are a lot of people very upset about that ranking, and more to the point, there are a lot of countries, and not included there, like India and Pakistan, which do very badly indeed, and they're not happy about this. And anyway, this is their ranking from 2016. 1 to 23 of no interest, but I've just included here regional peers, plus the countries that are contemplating nuclear startup, new nuclear power. So, United Arab Emirates, out of all those, rates highest, and for reasons which I'll explain in a moment, it's quite simple why that might be. Singapore, of course, has no nuclear power plant or other nuclear plants. Jordan, a small country in the Middle East with no oil, no gas, desperate to find something to do to get energy and not be beholden to their neighbours. They've got uranium, but it's pretty poor quality uranium. They've been really pushed to make use of. They pretend they're going to go nuclear. I frankly don't see it happening. Taiwan, of course, your neighbour, does have a lot of nuclear power. Indonesia has been thinking about it for a long, long time, and I don't think it's going down that path anytime soon. Bangladesh, now it has been very serious. Well, in principle, very serious. They got all sorts of agreements, and the website was telling me that construction on the Russian-provided nuclear power plant started in October. But then I couldn't find any news release saying that it actually happened. So I don't know. But they are deeply committed. But I believe that there are financial issues that may be holding things up. But there you go. Bangladesh is one of the nearest neighbours, regional neighbour, I suppose, contemplating going nuclear. And seriously contemplate. Philippines, well, don't need to explain. Vietnam was very committed until only a couple of years ago. Committed to the point that they had built up a massive workforce of highly trained professionals that would have done the job. They worked very closely with the Russians. They did have other options in play, but the Russians were the lead candidates. But they've made the decision not to persist. So if you go down the road of starting up, you can find a lot of expertise in Vietnam looking for jobs, frankly. And it's a sad thing to see. You know, I mean, this is real people. I mean, we're talking probably thousands who have gone through university and you know, postgraduate work and all the rest of it in nuclear science, technology, engineering, all the stuff you need to run a program, and suddenly they're told they don't have a career. And it happened to my generation in Australia because you know, it was the brightest of the best in the 1960s. Went off and did nuclear science at university when Australia was talking big about a nuclear power program. And by 1980 it was all finished. So we've got a whole bunch of nuclear scientists in Australia doing other things these days. Malaysia, not going anywhere. Some people are still talking, but I don't see it in Thailand likewise. So this is all by point of the rankings, and I guess my point was simply there are simple things that can be done, like filling in those gaps there, which can help get the ranking up. But what's the point of the ranking? Well, the point of the ranking is the perceptions, whether rightly or wrongly, whether the NTI survey is a good one or a bad one. Out there, opinion will be impacted by those perceptions. Now, with time rapidly running out, I just need to pass through the question of how you convince countries you're not going down the nuclear weapons path. It's very easy. You belong to the NPT. You have IAEA safeguards applied to everything. You adhere to best practice. Philippines is already an active participant in a thing called the Proliferation Security Initiative, which is a sort of a slightly hairy-chested sort of approach to countering proliferation, which involves interdiction of aircraft and vessels. And then you have the Security Council resolutions, which Carla is the absolute world expert on resolution 1540, so if there are any questions, I know where to turn for an answer. And so I end up with just a few thoughts here that you could look at the countries that are going ahead with the nuclear power program to get some ideas about how what you might need to do to restart in the case of the Philippines. The UAE, with money no object, has bought everything it needs to be a 5-star, 6-star player in this. It said it won't do reprocessing, it won't do enrichment, it will buy the best technology there is, it will buy the best expertise there is. And in that part of the world, you have to say thank you, that's good. Well, it's enough for everybody. I can still think that there'll be some people feeling a little uneasy about it. But they, and the Saudis for that matter, have a very simple motivation. They've got all this carbon stuff that they want to continue selling for a good price. And so they want to have another source for themselves so they can sell more to the rest of the world. And that way, lower their carbon footprint a bit. But the United Arab Emirates will, next year, though, the first reactor will be probably started. Bangladesh, it has got much the same, in some respects, the same characteristics as the United Arab Emirates, in that it does everything in partnership with the international community and with Russia. Russia's providing the two nuclear power plants that they propose to build. They have had the IAEA involved in every step of the way. They had the Director General, Yukiya Amano, there back in May, June or so, who gave his blessing to the progress that was being made, while emphasizing that best international standards would have to be applied. Curiously, this power plant that they're building in Bangladesh is not too far from the Indian border. And the Indians, of course, with a major program of their own, are taking an interest in it also, and that's a very sensible, neighbourly thing to do. And so it's not a bad idea to think about engaging your neighbours closely in your planning. And in this case, the Indians are doing some training, I think, for Bangladeshi technicians and Saudi Arabia will have the money to buy anything it wants, of course. Well, maybe not quite so today as it was, say, 10, 15 years ago, but still they can buy it if they want it. But they're not going to do what the Arab Emirates have said. They're not going to forego enrichment and reprocessing. So they are playing a bit of politics, I can see here, with Iran, one eye on Iran, and saying, you know, well, we'll keep you guessing as to what our real intentions are. And as I mentioned, Jordan, a poor country which is dear to my heart, but no oil, no gas, and desperate to find some way of producing energy, and I don't think their chances are very good. But they're all relatively good models. But here, Brazil today is not a bad model anymore, but for a long time they kept the nuclear enrichment option open because they wanted to have, they probably weren't doing it as a bomb, but they were certainly doing it as nuclear-powered submarines. Iran, we know, had some pretty big ambitions for things which were not peaceful, as did Iraq, Syria, and Libya. So there's the whole neighborhood was filled with some pretty bad players there, and Iraq got an reactor bombed by Israel, Syria the same, and Libya, they didn't quite get to the reactor stage, but the top of the Gaddafi put an end to that program, or before the Gaddafi went to take. But those programs were cleaned up. They all had clandestine programs, and we know about North Korea. So the summary of the points there: transparency, engagement with neighbours, engagement with the IAEA, stick to just power, and keep talking to your neighbours. And I ended up with a little checklist of those regional and international organisations that could be useful and would be relevant. And most of my time, and myself. But happy to answer questions or whatever, however you'd like to do it. Okay, well, yes, please, just do it now. To introduce the network that I'm working with, this website, which you have there on your handout that gives you the URL for it. So this is the network. The question was asked whether we had publications, and if we go to the policy brief tab, you'll see where we've done some 48 studies, 49 and 50 are in the pipeline, of different aspects of all matters nuclear. They're mostly non-proliferation disarmament issues, but they're the sprinkling of peaceful uses of nuclear power related issues. The thing that's unique about this Asia Pacific Leadership Network is that we try and get experts from within the region to address these issues. And the whole nuclear world has sort of been twisted. You know, it was sort of Russia, America, and then Atlantic orientation. But the epicenter of nuclear issues these days is really the Pacific, Indo-Pacific. And we're trying to get the focus, get that center, that new sort of geopolitical reality reflected in where work is done on these issues. Because the Americans, of course, and the Europeans and the Russians are still all heavily into these nuclear issues. But it's not yet, there's not yet a community, an Asia Pacific community, doing this work, and we're trying to get that to happen. Most of the studies we commission are done by experts from within the region. This is the list of members. We're 92, okay. I can't remember who the 92nd is, but And we've got from the Philippines some names you'll be familiar with. The membership is skewed, I have to say, to the those with the major nuclear industries of the known India, Pakistan, China, Korea, and Japan. Yes. Sri Lanka. Yes. No idea from Bangladesh. I've been working on that for 6 months, but I have so far failed. Okay. Well, look, let's open up to questions.
Good afternoon, Dr. I just wanted to get your opinion on the recently passed UN treaty to ban nuclear weapons. Do you think this treaty will be effective?
I'm glad my colleague is not here this afternoon. He's doing a presentation out of the Defense Staff, Defense College, on that very question. And we have somewhat differing views on this. I'm afraid I'm committed to the NPT. I was open-minded about this negotiation and actually wrote a piece which was up on the website arguing the Australian government should support the process and bring, you know, some balance to the negotiations. But for a number of reasons, and I have to say there's a lot of heavy US pressure involved, none of those countries that depend on the US nuclear umbrella took part except for the Netherlands. And the Netherlands, at the end of it, didn't support the treaty anyway, voted against. Look, the problem is that it's all good in principle, but a treaty which bans something and where the people who have those weapons don't belong to it is frankly irrelevant. Well, possibly worse, and this is where it becomes complex. It's not like the Chemical Weapons Convention, and it's not like the Landmines Convention, commonly cited as reasons why this is a good idea. Because with both those causes, you had a number of countries that actually possessed those weapons, but who were willing to part with them under some international framework. And that's what's happened. In the case of chemical weapons, I think a lot of the countries that had chemical weapons just kept them because their neighbour had them or they were concerned their neighbour would have them and blah, blah, blah. They now had a convention which enabled them to make a move to get rid of them. And of course, it hasn't got rid of them everywhere. In the case of chemical weapons, it's gone very close to doing that. But Israel and Egypt still outside, and you know. So, but it has done wonderful things. The Chemical Weapons Convention, which is absolutely fantastic, and the Landmines Convention also has done fantastic things. When you think of the number of countries that did have landmines and have now given them up, that is a huge plus. But with the Nuclear Weapons Convention ban treaty, the countries with nuclear weapons were quite clear from the very beginning they are not about to give them up. And the rest of the world had already made quite clear in the non-proliferation treaty that they are not going to get those. So, I'm sorry, it's not going to do anything. Except it makes some people feel good, which is not warranted because the task is still ahead of us. The real task of disarmament is still ahead of us. And so I wouldn't say it was necessarily a waste of time, but it was a productive time. And there's even a possibly worse point. And this is, you know, the nuclear weapons states, and in particular the Americans, after Obama, were saying, not only is this a bad idea, if you think you can demonize nuclear weapons, you've got another thing coming. You can't demonize them because we have got them and we are going to continue to insist on the possibility of their use. Now, we weren't hearing that stuff 10, 15 years ago, but the rhetoric of the last couple of years has got to the point where it's almost raising the relevance of nuclear weapons higher. And in part, of course, in part it's because of DPRK, in part it's because both the Americans and the Russians have got problems modernizing, and that's another big issue, and in part because they're trying to tell the world, don't believe that nuclear weapons have gone away because you've got this treaty. They're there, and if needs be, they'll be used. So the weapons, in some cruel sort of twist of fate, it's having this effect of making the use of them a bigger threat than it was before, perhaps. Sorry, not a welcome answer, I know, for many of those people, the Nobel Peace Prize winners, you know, that just think they've got a great treaty. I don't want to dampen down their enthusiasm, because in my early days I was a ban the bomber, and would have, you know, sort of thought this was the only way to go, you just had to ban them. Well, you just can't ban them. You've got to work out what we really need now. We've got the Americans and the Russians got to get together and get over their stupid behavior and get rid of some more weapons.
Any more questions?
Yes.
Oh, yes, please. May I kindly request that you state your name and office or institution?
I'm Matteo from the Office of the Consular Affairs.
Office of the
Consular Affairs.
Yes.
Good afternoon, sir. My question is, you said earlier that the key treaty is the non-proliferation treaty, which is, correct me if I'm wrong, India is a non-signatory of this treaty, and although they have, they always said that they're for peaceful use of their nuclear capacities, and they also tell that they have this no first use policy. So, with regards to this and all of the other countries, or some countries who are not part of the treaty, how do we assess, or is there a way that we can regulate their nuclear capacity?
How do we assess their nuclear capacity?
Yes, how do we assess?
Yeah.
For example, for North Korea, it's happening right now. So.
Yes, that's a good question. Of course, the faith we have in the NPT, again, like the nuclear ban treaty, it's only good for those countries that have signed the NPT. So, what happened, pretty well every country in the world, barring India, Pakistan, Israel, signed the NPT. Even North Korea signed the NPT. Now, we probably should have known that India, Pakistan and Israel were going to go down the route of getting the nuclear weapon, Otherwise, why wouldn't they have signed the NPT? And sadly, you know, a country like India, which for so long paraded its sort of opposition to nuclear weapons and said it was never going to do it and blah, blah, blah. Well, lo and behold, they had a peaceful nuclear explosion. And then, lo and behold, a few years later, they had a not so peaceful nuclear explosion. It was the same sort of explosion, but it was just coming clean about their intentions. So, you know, we've learned to live with it, I guess, is the reality of it. I mean, we tried for a decade or more to say, well, that's not good enough, India, that's not good enough, Pakistan, and we're all silent about Israel because Israel hasn't tested, as far as we know, and it sort of doesn't say it has or has it. So we just have to imagine we know, we think we know they've got them. But with India and Pakistan, we know they've got them, and they, as part of their national defense system, that they're deployed, they're ready for use, they have nuclear deterrence operating. But for a long time, we were sort of saying, well, now get back into the box, you know, where we don't allow this. Then, you know, a few years back, we sort of came to the realization that this wasn't going to work, and so we've been inviting them to join this group, famously known as the Nuclear Suppliers Group, which is attempts to sort of bring all countries into some sort of discipline, behavior, and prevention of further proliferation. So we'd say to India, in fact, well, India, we haven't said, and India hasn't got into the Nuclear Suppliers Group yet either, but saying to them more or less, if you promise not to help anybody else get a bomb, then okay, you can join our club and we'll all try and stop anybody else getting a bomb. So that was sort of where we were at. And then, of course, Deep Dark Hate went off the tracks and left the NPT. The rest is history. So we've had one defector from the NPT that turned out badly. We had one case, Iran, which looked like it might have turned out badly, but we think it's sort of containable. If everybody is sensible and works hard at containing, keeping going. But DPRK, of course, is you know, now the question is, DPRK, do we get rid of its nukes overnight? Well, it's not going to happen. And a lot of voices now in America saying, you know, we just have to accept the fact that they will have to be deterred. And I put this to an Australian colleague recently, and you know, this seems to be popular. So what? You think that, you know, deterrence wasn't already applying? Well, of course he's right. I mean, the Americans, without articulating it, have been using their implied nuclear threat to try and get the DPRK to adhere to some sort of limits. But it's not playing the game, you know. But anyway, I think the answer, you know, with the DPRK now is that, frankly, we're just going to have to accept that it's got a capacity to hit targets. South Korea would just be a car park at the end of, you know, any exchange. Seoul would be a car park. And it's a pretty terrible prospect, but they can hit targets in Korea, Japan, and probably America now, not to mention in China and Russia. So what I'm trying to do is say to the Chinese and the Russians, come on, yeah, it's your problem too. And does it help?
Thank you very much. Next question. Before we proceed to the next question, I'd like to raise this. One of the there were some talks on how to address the DPRK conundrum of how do we address this proliferation threat, or the capacity, nuclear weapon capacity. And one of the issues that was raised, one of the things that was thought about is that we accept that the strategy should be post-proliferation, that we accept their capacity, and put in, we're able to engage them in some sort of having safeguards, security in some sort of that. So that it's like, your capacity is always there, so how do we deal with it? If the option of actually overturning the regime is not that.
Yeah, look, this is, it's been an issue that in our network meetings over the last 18 months, been a constant theme. Where to now, you know, putting the bomb back in the box is not going to happen. It's going to need a combination of carrots and sticks. The sticks are already there, they're pretty obvious. The carrots are hardly at all there. In fact, at the moment we still seem to be going through a phase of increasing the sticks and not even talking about carrots. So this reimposing, Washington reimposing the terrorist act on DPRK, the designation of a terrorist country. So the Americans are still ramping up the level of sort of pressure. The Chinese, very curiously, are doing a lot more now than they were doing. It's quite clear until recently, until the last 12 months or so, in fact, more specifically since Obama's gone, it's sad to say, and Trump is there, that they are doing more about reducing the flow of traffic across the river. And whether you can wind up the pressure to the point that Pyongyang sees sense and gives up its weapons, well, I don't think that will ever happen. So I guess the calculation, and I'm sure no one seriously thinks that in Washington anymore. So what they're looking at, I guess, is building up the pressure of, on the one side. But at some stage, they're going to have to match up with a series of carrots. And it's going to have to be a huge package. And the Iran deal gives you a sense of the magnitude of what's required. So the point is, we've sort of been there before. The outcome will be different because in the case of Iran, it was sort of stopping them getting weapons. In the case of DPRK, the weapons are there, it's going to be about doing something to stop them being deployed, stopping them being further produced. And I don't know that anybody's really got a roadmap for how it's going to be managed. If someone does have it, they haven't shared it with me, and I don't think they shared it with anybody else in the region. But it's going to have to be massive. It's going to be. You remember, see, last time we went through this, back in '92, thereabouts, the idea was that the South Koreans, with Japanese money and a lot of American arm twisting and the rest of it, would build a 1,000-megawatt nuclear power plant in North Korea. We had this wonderful organization called the Korean Economic Development Organization, which was providing the vast quantities of fuel oil into the North Korean economy to keep the electricity generators going and things like that, pending the building of a nuclear power plant in North Korea. know, there's some stories that the idea was, the thinking in the back of the Americans' mind was, because they never expected that nuclear power plant to be handed over to the North Koreans, because at that time, and I would have agreed with them, the expectation was that the North Korean regime would collapse any day. It was such a mess in the early 90s. It was in the mid-90s, and even by... It was a shocking mess. By the late 90s, it was a shocking mess. So when this is all being talked about, the expectation was that it would never actually be in the hands of Kim Jong-il, as it was at the time. But the problem was, you now have... that would not be enough to buy a deal. And not one nuclear power plant, you'd probably be, if you were talking nuclear power plants, but whether anybody wants to talk about nuclear power plants again, I don't know. But the package of support for the North would have to be massive. Then the political commitments to the regime survival would have to be massive. And the Koreans, your Koreans make it very clear that they've gone down this route because they've seen what has happened to other dictators who gave up their nuclear option. Saddam, Gaddafi, not to mention Assad still struggling to survive. So they won't. Current regime won't. We don't know when the regime might collapse. To get us over this current crisis, we just have to manage the regime, we have to manage their weapons, we have to manage their security expectations, and their economic expectations. And at the moment, I don't see anybody who's really prepared to step up and accept that bargain. Chinese haven't got to that point. I think the Russians are probably saying, you know, when you call on us to help, we will, but you know, we're not going to take the lead. Meanwhile, the Americans are also saying, well, you know, don't look to us to bail everybody out. So it's not looking very pretty.
Thank you very much. Any more questions? Yes.
I'm Luigi from the Presidential Commission on Visiting Forces. Considering the geographical placement of the Philippines, which is within the Pacific Ring of Fire and is vulnerable to inevitables such as earthquakes and tidal waves, upon your professional observation and calculation, does the Philippines have the capability to undertake or revive its nuclear energy program and eventually face its repercussions, or is it in the advantage of the Philippines to better focus on renewable forms of energy instead?
Yeah, well, that's look, all I can say is that the experts say there are circumstances in which nuclear power can still be commercially and environmentally, I suppose, a good option. I mean, I think the environmental benefits are pretty more or less clear, but the first and biggest hurdle is, can you make it a commercially viable option? And that is not easy to answer this day and age. But, you know, obviously some still think it is, and Bangladesh is one case in our part of the world. Now, the seismic issues, of course, are challenging, and all I can say is that others have, I'm no seismic expert, I don't know whether your seismic challenges are any better or any less than those facing Japan. But of course, pointing to Japan, there's no point in the rumors for Fukushima, and we're seeing Japan, a country with a huge investment in the nuclear industry, really struggling now to know how to manage the future. There's still a long way from making any clear and firm national position on it, although reactors are being restarted. Korea, I think, probably far less threatened by seismic events than Japan, but nevertheless sort of still on the rim there, I guess, has taken the decision not to expand its current commitments, but it already has a very, very large commitment, which will be going for decades and decades. And meanwhile, China is going gangbusters in building new power plants. I think the answer is the technical people, and I'm not one of them, will say you can safely build if you site properly and you take all the necessary precautions, which will add to the cost, of course. And you can take heart. I think you can take heart from the fact that the Fukushima thing was really most nuclear accidents have been almost impossible to explain. The one in Russia Chernobyl. The Chernobyl happened because the people driving that thing drove it like a jumbo jet and turned off all engines and said, "What happens now?" You know, and well, that's what happens. The plane falls out of the sky, the reactor goes into free fall, and it's not pretty. And interestingly, the first people to find out about the Chernobyl accident were in Sweden. I think they're 1,500 kilometers away, further than your nearest neighbor, or Vietnam. Seismic is a public, it's something to be done, it can be managed. But public opinion, of course, is really very difficult to manage, and I don't know how you do that politically. In the Philippines, I don't know how. We can't do it in Australia, where seismic is not even an issue. Partly because the economics are not good. We've got enough coal and gas to kill the planet with greenhouse gases completely, if we can try hard. So there's no motivation there. Sorry, just to I would add that some of these new technologies also, you know, if you don't do it in the next 10 or 20 years, it may well be that, you know, later on, things like these small reactors I was talking about, where you just sort of drop them and let them light up a small island or something like that for 10 years and then take them away, they may still be a solution for certain circumstances.
Any more questions?
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Anbon from the Foreign Service Institute. My question concerns the response of Japan to North Korea's nuclear provocations. Actually, there's been debates whether Japan would be developing own nuclear weapons since it's been necessitated by the current crisis in North Korea, and considering its reliance in the U.S. nuclear umbrella, as well as its three non-nuclear principles, what are your opinions regarding Japan's potential development of nuclear weapons?
Yeah, that's also a good question, and of course this is the problem about the whole North Korean, not the only problem about North Korean, but one of the major spin-off issues to do with the North Korean issue is in managing it, do we manage it in such a way that we don't see Japan and South Korea, for that matter, feeling obliged to take the nuclear route themselves. And given the state of their fuel cycle expertise, given their scientific structures, infrastructure, they could do it very easily. I don't know whether it's months or years, but it wouldn't be many years, it would be years. So it's a problem of security management, and it's a problem of alliance management in a way for the Americans to convince the Japanese and the Koreans that they don't have to go down that route. And I mean, what I think we're going to see is a lot of rather destabilizing posturing about all this, because it gets to be played out in a domestic political context. So you'll get people in Japan and Korea, South Korea, saying, "Well, for national security reasons, we have no choice but to the Americans aren't giving us 100% cast iron guarantee that they can blast North Korea off the face of the earth before they lob something into Tokyo. So we're going to do it ourselves." Well, I don't think it works that way, and I don't think it would be helpful for Japan to actually go down that route. For the time being, I think both they and the Koreans have got enough nuclear weapon action on their side. If they had their own nukes, they'd become their own nuclear target as well. So I think it would only complicate the situation even and make it more dangerous for them. But it will be played out in domestic politics, so there will be this sort of threatening. And lo and behold, would you believe that even in Australia, some academics, one academic, former very senior defence official, said, Australia should probably keep its, keep the option in mind, not do anything, but not forget about the option. If it all falls apart elsewhere, we'll probably have to think again. It's not going to happen in your lifetime, I hope. But anyway, I think the solution has to be that they don't go down that route, but we will probably hear a lot more crackle on the radio between, before the issue is resolved.
Any more questions? Going once, going twice. Thank you very much, everyone, for your questions, and for Mr. Talman for answering all of these questions.